bop, lop, bam, boom.
Peace and quiet. What a contrast. It doesn't seem possible that it could be the same town, but it is. This peaceful garden and the crescent are no more than a couple of hundred yards from the brash, noisy excitement that we've just been enjoying.
The crescent was built about 1830 with all the classical dignity that 1830 was capable of. And then, a few years later in the 1840s, these three tremendous villas were built. I say tremendous because houses like these, they were built as houses, though they're all museums and things now. Houses as ambitious as these in size and quality are really unusual to find in the middle of a town. But not only is this grandeur side by side with the candy flossery down by the harbour, they were both built for exactly the same reason, so that people could come for a paddle, to be beside the seaside.
Actually, to be honest, the first holidaymakers came to Scarborough to take the waters, not of the sea itself, but of the medicinal springs which were discovered here in the 1620s and which were very soon being resorted to by people of good fashion. So that Scarborough's first fame as a holiday resort was as a spa town.
This is the spa. Not the original building, of course, but the one rebuilt with an appropriately grandiose Victorian elegance in the 1870s. As a fashionable activity, sea bathing started much later than taking the waters. It started in the 1730s, but gradually it took over entirely in popularity. And just beyond the spa, the Victorians built for that activity too, little late 19th century bathing huts and a caff, so pretty in the setting, so appropriate.
I've used that word twice in the last few seconds, because the Victorians seem to have had the knack of quite unself-consciously putting up the right building in the right place.
And this is the granddaddy of them all, the Grand Hotel, built in the 1860s and one of the great hotel buildings of the world. Absolutely monumental in scale and outline, but just as satisfying close too, because the whole facade is decorated richly, but not excessively, in a way which is typical of the very best of high Victorian design. Great voluted brackets support the cornice, and enormous caryatid statues decorate the corners. It's in a style all of its own. Built in the wrong material, far too big for anything else in the town, and yet it works perfectly. The architect was a Yorkshireman, Cuthbert Broderick, who was the designer of the equally outstanding Leeds Town Hall.
His building here dominates the centre of Scarborough, and from it you can see two quite distinct towns. If you look down this side, you can see the old town, huddled on the steep hill along the side of the harbour.
It's a very old town. Even Richard III seems to have come here for his hollies. The front, of course, has been changed entirely by the entertainment industry. But even down here, you can catch moments of the old atmosphere, little cobbled, seasidey moments. The occasional older house in mellow brick, an old inn with 17th century details, a little timber-framed house with original brick nogging. Streets with a nice cottagey Georgian feel to them. And beyond them, the real historic town, the splendid medieval parish church on the hilltop, and the mighty Norman castle on its impregnable promontory above the sea. But if you look the other side from the Grand, not a hint of jumble to be seen. Everything on this side has been laid out, planned, and it's really an exceptionally successful town. First of all, down below us is the valley, landscaped in the 1830s and containing the extraordinary little round museum. And then, up on the cliff tops on the south side, rows and rows of elegant terraces, faithfully and brilliantly using the rise and fall of the land to create a constantly varied scene, climbing and curving, delicately and prettily painted. I was going to call it the Brighton of the North, but I don't see why I should imply that it's second best to anywhere. The earliest terraces up here are Regency, beautifully integrated, of course, as terraces have to be, but animated too by the repetitive rhythm of the bow windows.
Isn't it good to see how easily and comfortably this 1930s house on the corner fits in with the Regency Terrace beyond? Good townscape, whatever we might think of places like the Grand Hotel, normally depends on the ability of different periods to be comfortable with each other.
This later part of the town is a delight to walk through, partly for the overall concept, but for the detail too, the architectural detail, the gardens, and especially the wealth of marvellous ironwork.
I have to admit that I came to Scarborough with preconceptions. I haven't been for a long time, and I thought of the place as nothing more than a gaudy seaside resort. Nothing wrong with that, of course. I love gaudy seaside resorts. But that's the category that I'd put it into, and I'm sure that a lot of people think that way. We seem determined to categorise places, to stereotype them. But when you really come to look at them, they don't fit. There's always far more than you expect.
Ah.